Thank you. Thank you. When I arrived at North Carolina Dance Theater and I was about to meet Jean-Pierre and Patricia, I just didn't know what to expect. I don't know if you've heard, but artistic folk can be pretty challenging sometimes. And the challenge becomes bigger the more talented that they are. And you couldn't ask for two more talented and amazing people. Jean-Pierre was in the Paris Opera Ballet by the time that he was age 14 and proceeded to dance with the Bolshoi, the Kirov, and New York City Ballet, where he performed in over 40 ballets. As the 70s came to a close and the collared shirts were put away, JP decided to stop performing and to focus his energies on his work as a choreographer and as a teacher. And something else happened. He married Patricia McBride. Patricia had won a scholarship to the School of American Ballet when she was just 13 years old. By 18, she was the youngest principal dancer for New York City Ballet. From there, her career skyrocketed. Appearances on television, roles choreographed specifically for her by Jerome Robbins, John Terras, and of course, Mr. George Balanchine. When her longtime partner, Mikhail Baryshnikov, she and Mikhail performed for five sitting presidents at the White House and was acclaimed by the most respected dance critic of the 20th century as merely the most exciting ballerina in America. Obviously, Jean-Pierre and Patricia have the kind of professional pedigree that you just can't touch. But what are they like in person? Well, when I finally met them, I was astonished. So delightfully real, approachable, and just plain nice. I found them personally inspiring. They are phenomenal people, and they make a phenomenal pair. In ballet, when two dancers perform together, they call it a pas de deux. Jean-Pierre and Patricia performed many pas de deux together. Though not dancing on stage, this pair is still making steps and strides together, performing a pas de deux that is making a lasting impact on the art form of dance, our artists, our community, and our audiences.
You know, here in New York City, we're very proud of our New York City Ballet, Edward Villella, Patricia McBride.
Patricia had this energy on stage that I've never seen in another performer. I mean, it was just this infectious energy and excitement when she performed.
She's like a ballet rock star. You can go into a dictionary and look up Patricia McBride, and she's there as one of the greatest American ballerinas. And I've done it.
He was in that elite group, a level that they call stars. They call him étoile. And that means he's one of the finest dancers of his time. And people think of him as having this really finely tuned classical background. And he does.
Jean-Pierre and Patty are to ballet what Pavarotti was to opera. I mean, they are world class.
She was the one that was the star here in America, but he was her star, and together they make a great team. I think they just met when Jean-Pierre went to New York City Ballet. She was there, and they knew that was it. They have their daughter Melanie, who's expecting soon, and their son Chris, who lives here.
We had a really incredible childhood. We grew up in New York City, which sounds really big, and it's not. We still had play dates, and my folks still tucked us into bed. My mom made dinner, took us to school in the mornings. So really a very normal childhood.
We were always really close. We actually did, when we were really young, we actually did taekwondo together. And we both had our belts. We got our, we made it to like yellow belt, which is the second one, but we still had a good time joking around.
My father came to see the 3D, 4D ultrasound, which is just extraordinary. And he came with me and was just great to have him there. And apparently she did not want to cooperate because she was sleeping, but she had her leg twisted up by her head. And my dad pointed, goes, look, look, look at the flexibility. Look, we have a dancer.
He and Patricia are both very humble, but they have danced everywhere. They have met everybody, danced for presidents. It's just a matter of course for them.
Edward Villela, Baryshnikov, I'm sure she danced with Rudolf Nureyev. I would say you name it, she performed with that person. She was just at that level. They worked with, both worked with George Balanchine, who is the premier American choreographer of our time.
George Balanchine choreographed many works on Patricia McBride and as her as a muse.
Of course, so has Jean-Pierre. He worked directly with Mr. Balanchine, and I'm sure you know and have heard the stories. He's left on Paris Opera. He was a principal dancer there in Etoile, came to America to kind of start over because he wanted to work with this man. I mean, they're both legends.
I was just talking to Patty the other day in the studio about how often she used to dance with Baryshnikov. He talks about Nureyev's defection and having a part in that. They're not only iconic in by American standards, but they've had an impact globally on dance.
I was upstairs going through some stuff, and I came across a picture of my mom next to this man, and I looked at it, and I called for her, and she said, oh, yes, look at that photo. And I said, yeah, Mom, is that the President of the United States of America? And she goes, well, he was the President of the United States of America. And I said, these should be framed and hung up. She goes, oh, nobody wants to see these things hung in someone's home.
Well, Jean-Pierre, first and foremost, in my opinion, is one of the most kind people that I've come across. He is very collaborative with his dancers. You're part of the process.
I have always found him to be very musical, which isn't always the case for choreographers.
Yeah, some choreographers and heads of companies, artistic directors, can be real tyrants. And they're the opposite of that. They have a real nurturing quality about both of them. So that's wonderful.
I think as I've gotten older, I've come to realize just how much they work. I think, oh, you guys work a lot.
He's a thinking person, and I think that's another thing that causes the depth of the arts in our company, is that there's more to it than just, well, these are the steps.
I just remember this one little girl, and I say little, she's probably around 12 or 13, went up to her and said, oh, you know, Patty, my back is kind of hurting me. I think it's because, you know, I hurt my foot yesterday. She was just trying to explain why she wouldn't be doing something full out. Patricia sits her down, starts rubbing her back, and then says, oh, no, you said it was your foot. Takes her pointe shoes off and says, well, this is what I used to do, is rubbing her calf, just being so sweet. And the little girl, I don't even think at that point knows how lucky she is. Patricia McBride's giving her a massage and isn't thinking anything about it.
I'm not sure if people realize what we have here. It's quite amazing, their reputation and what they have accomplished as far as dancers in their careers and what they've brought to us here in Charlotte.
I guess they're in the stratosphere of the ballet world of America, right?
And yet they have this extraordinary talent and incredible capacity just to love and give back. They felt blessed to be able to do something that they loved and share it with so many people. So they feel like the lucky ones. And we're so lucky to have had that in our lives.
They are above and beyond. They are amazing people, not just to me, but I've seen them do the same thing for every single dancer in the company. If you need something, they're there.
Working for the both of them has been really a dream and the thing that's made my life renew.
I just love them to death. I love them.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, Jean-Pierre Bonnefoux and Patricia McBride.
Ladies and gentlemen, for distinguished achievement in visual art, the Arts and Science Council is proud to present a 2008 ASC honor to Herb Jackson. Please welcome Brad Thomas.
Good evening. I first met Herb Jackson at a dinner party when I was a student at UNC Charlotte. I was kind of a know-it-all art punk, but I have to admit I was a little bit intimidated. I was aware of the fact that Herb was one of the most successful and best-known painters in the region, and over the years, his textured, poetic landscapes have inspired an international following. He's had over 100 solo exhibitions in the U.S. and England, Peru, Portugal, and Canada. His work was also included in the first-ever exhibition of American contemporary paintings in the former Soviet Union. And through his leadership, he single-handedly developed a nationally recognized exhibitions and collections program at Davidson College. In fact, Herb facilitated the area's first solo exhibition of Charlotte native Romare Bearden, who is now a household name. Well, at that dinner party, any intimidation I felt quickly evaporated when Herb graciously initiated a conversation with me about my own artwork. That evening, he treated me like a fellow artist, not as a student, not as a hobbyist, but I think he could sense the urgency and the seriousness within me, and he was interested in taking the extra time to encourage me about my own artwork. And a few years after that initial meeting, I was visiting Davidson College and the new Van Avery Smith Galleries, and on view was a selection of recent acquisitions to their collection. And there on the wall, installed between a lithograph by American master Robert Motherwell and a large photo collage by the renowned British artist David Hockney, was a piece of my own work. Herb had purchased it a few months earlier for Davidson, and I was ecstatic that he did, but when I saw my work on that wall between those two 20th century masters, I felt a feeling of self-worth that I'd never known before. And I guess in many ways, it was an opportunity from an established and successful artist to a know-it-all art punk. Being an artist is often a very lonely endeavor, and it is the moments of generosity and acceptance, especially in one's formative years, that propel us forward. And now, many years later, I'm the director and curator of that very same art program at Davidson, and it is my mission to provide opportunities and encouragement for other young artists. Well, I had the best example there is in Herb Jackson.
He is a person who thinks about the way things go against one another, the flows, the hot colors, the cool colors, the rhythm of jazz.
Throughout the candle art history, he's one of the most consistently hardworking and consistently produces paintings which are dazzling.
He's admired by many people because of his kindness, and he has helped many, many artists in this area, helping them by just advice or being there.
He creates unbelievably beautiful art, but does that at the same time that he is changing people's lives in the classroom.
The painting shows you the hard thinking side of Herb and the ephemeral side of Herb.
Dad has always had this shape and flow, and he'll talk at length about it. He's uncovering his journey into his lairs. He's discovering shapes and colors. It feels like uncovering of his personality or his desires and dreams, and but they're all in just abstract shapes and colors which jump out at you.
This one is Veronica's Veils. This is what I call his signature piece. Herb was influenced by a Baroque painter that did a painting in the 6th century, and the name was Veronica's. And Veronica's myth is that Veronica was supposedly had wiped Jesus' face with her veil, and thus the face came back into the veil. It's a myth. It's a total myth. It's nothing religious. But the painting is always 60 inches tall by 48 inches wide, and it has the same trademarks on each side. It's a forever ongoing series until Herb decides to stop it. Right now, I think we're at 185.
Well, none of my grandparents were artists. Dad, in many ways, had to fight to further his art practice. When he went to Davidson, he had to go as pre-med. His father said if you go to study that art, he wouldn't help further his education. But I'm pretty sure he ended up as a German major at Davidson. And so that let him go for his study abroad to study art in Germany.
Herb's parents were 38 when he was born, and they were both in business. And you know, Herb has been building great institutions here in the Charlotte area. And I think it's because he learned so much from his business parents.
After he left college, he went to grad school and ended up teaching at Davidson.
Herb and I met in high school art class. We did not go out. We mostly debated. Then he went to Davidson and I went to Wellesley College. And we've been married now 41 years.
I grew up in a museum, literally. The house, it's all a huge collection of art.
You always had an easel stocked with paint. Any interest you wanted to pursue, it was allowed.
We've spent time watching Dad in the studio whenever we can.
I remember when I was maybe in third grade, and you're learning to draw, you know. I said, I can't draw noses. And so we sat down at the table, and it wasn't, I remember at the time I expected him to say, well, this is how you draw a nose. And instead of it being a literal, technical, this is one way to draw a nose, which in the long run would have been kind of a waste. It was more a way of looking at the world.
He's a wonderful teacher and has won our highest teaching award and is really highly regarded by our students. It's hard to express how unusual it is to find someone who is as talented as an artist who also loves teaching. He has this unique combination of both.
His students absolutely love him because they come in here and buy canvas for their classes. And so when we ask him, oh, this must be for Herb Jackson's class, yes. And we say, well, how is it? Oh, we just love him. He's an incredible artist and an incredible professor.
I mean, he's a remarkable artist, and I think, you know, it shows by the fact that his work is as popular as it is.
Here's a painter who's one of the most technically amazing painters that I certainly know throughout art history.
So this painting has hundreds of layers. You can see the great energy, the great creative energy of the sunrise. He particularly loves the sunrise.
Machine, machine, machine. I heard you cry.